He blew his ruh in Adam alayhi salam. He made angels to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. And in the same way, he also commanded Iblis to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. Because some people didn't think that Iblis used to be an angel, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he was approaching this subject, he said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس أبى واستكبر وكان من الكافرين. And some people thought that, well, if Allah said so, it means that Iblis was among the angels, which is not true, because Surah Al-Kahf is responding to that. Surah Al-Kahf is responding to that by telling us that Iblis wasn't among the angels, he was among jinn, and in fact he was the father of jinn, because Allah said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس كان من الجن ففسق عن أمر ربه أفتتخذونه وذريته أولياء من دون الله من دوني وهم لكم عدو بئس للظالمين بدلا أفتتخذونه وذريته ففهمنا منها. We understood from this that his progeny, he is the father of them. أفتتخذونه وذريته من دون أولياء وهم لكم عدو بئس للظالمين بدلا. So the translation is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the angel to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, and he commanded in same time Iblis, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clarifying to us that Iblis, he was among jinn, and in fact he is the father of jinn in this Surah Al-Kahf, in this verse in Surah Al-Kahf. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you all of us, we know that Adam alayhi salam, he was the father of mankind. Now, before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or what did make Adam alayhi salam so important that Allah made or commanded angels to prostrate to him and Iblis also to prostrate him? So the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. First, let me answer to this one, because sometimes we are accusing Adam alayhi salam, because we are here, we are here because of the mistake of Adam alayhi salam. And that's what our brothers and sisters in Christianity, that's what they are saying. They are saying, we are here because of the sin of Adam alayhi salam. And in fact, this is not the truth, because Allah already is informing us in the same surah, Surah Al-Baqarah, by telling us, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإذ قال ربك للملائكة إني جاعل في الأرض خليفة. He already said to the angel before he created Adam عليه السلام that he is going to create a vicegerent in the earth. So this is the place where he will be with him and his progeny, and Allah will, this is the place of test, the trial. Allah will try them, will test them in this earth, because the fact that Allah created us for Jannah, He didn't create us for the earth. But you have to go or to pass through this process. If you don't, you are not clean and pure, you didn't pass here, you cannot go there, because Jannah is something else. Now, so Allah already informed the angel that he will create a vicegerent for this earth. So Adam alayhi salam, whether he passed the test in that place where he was or he failed, he will come to the earth anyway. Just depending on which time he will come to the earth. That's the question. So now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before he commanded, or I will answer the question, what made Adam alayhi salam so unique? Because Allah said, when he was informing the angels that he will create a vicegerent in this earth, he said after that, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا ثُمَّ عَرَضَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ فَقَالَ أَنْبِئُونِي بِأَسْمَاءِ. Anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam alayhi salam. Asma here is knowledge. He taught him knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wanted, Allahu a'lam bi muradih, he wanted to show to the angel that this new creature is different. So he presented the things that he taught to Adam alayhi salam to the angels. And he told them, okay, can you inform us about these items or these things? He said, Subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal 'alimul hakim. Qala ya Adam anbi'hum bi asma'i. Then he told Adam, okay, what about you? Can you talk them these items, the names or verbal nouns on things? And Adam alayhi salam started teaching them. When Adam started teaching them, they saw or they feel that this man is very, very high level. The knowledge that he has made him very respectful. And you look at him as professor with respect. So in that time when Allah is telling them, okay, now you can prostrate them, it was easy for them. They don't even think about it. Prostrate, he deserved it. And they prostrated them. But arrogance, Iblis was so arrogant when he told them, he commanded them too. Because Surah Al-A'raf is saying so. Because there is a command for the angels and command for Iblis too. Surah Al-A'raf said so. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-A'raf, A'udhu billahi minashaitanir rajim, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ صَوَّرْنَاكُمْ وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ صَوَّرْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجُدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ لَمْ يَكُن مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ قَالَ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَلَّا تَسْجُدَ إِذْ أَمَرْتُكَ. Allah said again, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ صَوَّرْنَاكُمْ. We created you and we shape you, give you the shape of your face, of your identity. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ صَوَّرْنَاكُمْ ثُمَّ. And we say to the angels, prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. And they prostrated, except Iblis. He wasn't among those who were prostrating. Now Allah is talking to him directly. He said, مَا مَنَعَكُ, what prevented you from not prostrating when I commanded you? So it's very clear that Allah said, when I commanded you, it means that He has a command too. You understand what I'm saying? Because this is the confusion about some scholars. I think Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah, he's the one who said that he was among angels. And the confusion came from this. Because all of us were human. The only one who is infallible is the Messenger of Allah. Al-Ma'soom is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. He is the one who is, in a matter of deen, he cannot make mistake. And any other one can make mistake. And he didn't pay attention to this verse in Surah Al-A'raf that Allah is mentioning that He commanded him to. If He commanded him to, you don't need to say that he was among the angels. But he wasn't among the angels. Because the Surah Al-Kahf, that verse explained that he was among jinn. And he has progeny, of course. So, Adam or his progeny, without knowledge, they are nothing. Because Allah didn't command them to prostrate to him before having knowledge. When he had the knowledge that he deserved to be respected. From the beginning, Allah said, I am going to send or create someone who will be my vice shared in this earth. And Surah Hud is meant in one verse in Surah Hud, I think it's Surah, verse 60 or 61. Surah Hud. Allah says, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, summarizing why we are sent to the earth. By saying, هو أنشأكم من الأرض واستعمركم فيها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about Himself. هو أنشأكم من الأرض He created you from the earth. واستعمره فيها. استعمر in Arabic, this seal, استدلال, استعمار, قلب الشيء. It means that we request you to do something. When Allah said واستعمركم فيها, it means that Allah is asking you or commanding you to build up this earth and beautify this earth and live in this earth in prosperity and happiness. Okay? Not in killing each other or promoting hatred with each other. You understand what I'm saying? The goal we are here is to beautify this earth according to our level. Make it as Jannah, as paradise, this earth. You should make it as a paradise at human level. Because when you go to Jannah, you will compare what you did as human with what Allah is doing for you. You are reaching the highest level and perfect in what you think. There is nothing better than that. You will feel yourself that you are doing nothing comparing to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for you or what He did for you. But now if we are busy in killing each other or promoting hatred with each other, there is no way you can fulfill this goal that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us all. There is no way we can do that because we are busy with something as well, oriented in the wrong way. In the wrong way, and this is what not what Allah wants from us. And how we can fulfill that, how we can beautify this earth, is by worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what do you mean? Meaning that to perfect this life according to the human level, you have to follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what the concept of worship is about. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, I didn't create jinn and mankind except to worship me. What does it mean? It means to obey my commands, to fulfill this goal I sent them for. Because I like them, I like to see them using the fruit of their brain to be created and to create beautiful things in this life. When they come to me, they will see the difference. But if they are not using the fruit of their brain in beautifying this earth, they will not really feel the difference because they don't have no clue about it before. And again, the worship, concept of worship, whether you worship Allah or you don't worship Him, this will not do nothing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Worshipping Allah again is good for mankind and for jinn. I will not talk that much about jinn. Okay? Worshipping Allah, it means that, or the fruit of that will come to a human, not to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will cannot change anything in His kingdom, whether all mankind worship them, or all mankind didn't worship them, they disobey them. This will not change nothing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it will change ourselves. It will change the problems, it will change our social life and our communication with each other. It will have an impact. By obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be a positive and constructive impact. By disobeying, it will be a horrible thing that no one wants to think about. You understand? So, I like also in the same, we're still in A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem. We're still in A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem. I like also to mention, because I saw in, I'm talking about the concept of worship. I can come to it also when we start talking about A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem. Iyyaka na'budu. I can. But because we are talking about the worship, and Allah has sent us for that, to worship Him, to accomplish the verse in Surah Hud, هُوَ أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَاسْتَعْمَرَكُمْ فِيهَا. And the colonialists, the invader on the Muslim countries, when they are coming, they are saying we are coming for istiamar. Istiamar. They know Quran better than us. They know before they came and invade Muslim countries, they know about their deen more than Muslim. And they choose this beautiful word, istamarakum fiha, to come. They think that we know our deen better. And they said, we are coming just for istamar. For istamar, to beautify this earth for you, beautify your country. But the Muslims don't know even what does istamar mean. And because of their invasion, they look at istamar as something bad. The word istamar is in their mind was printed because of that. The consequence, they think that istamar is something wrong, something bad, it's not good, which is no istamar, it's a beautiful word. And they choose it to mislead Muslims by telling them, we are coming to make istamar, to beautify your land and your earth for you. They are taken from the Quran. Anyway, many translations, English translation, instead of worshipper, you can find slave and servant, sometimes servant of Allah, sometimes slave of Allah. And I like to clarify this one. In many, if not all of them, all the translation, English translation, they are saying like that. I will tell you one thing. I will tell you, if you learn today just this one, you are learning too much. Just this, the concept of worship, just this one. Because translation is full of this mistake. What does being slave mean? Or what does being servant mean? And you can hear it, even some imams will come to the member, the khutbah or sermon. Thus, keep talking, we are the slave of Allah, we are the servant of Allah, and which is not right. Make it very clear. Alhamdulillah, many of you, they have children. Did someone of you, one time in his life, thought to say to his son or his daughter, be my son, or be my daughter? I am asking. You don't need to answer, but just think about it. Did you say, or it comes sometimes in your mind to remind your son, your daughter, by telling them or telling her, be my son or be my daughter? Or is your father certain time told you that? I will answer. If you disagree, you can raise your hand. No one has this idea. No one has this idea. For one simple reason, that it's obvious. Doesn't come to your mind. You would never think to say to your son, be my son. Or your son will tell you, be my father. Doesn't come. Why? Because it's obvious. It's obvious. You don't tell him like that. What it has to do with what I am talking about? What it has to do with what I am talking about? Allah will never tell you, be my slave. Because being slave of Allah, what do you mean by it? Because I know the slaves, they are doing, working for their master. And the master is abusing of them. So if I apply it at the level of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what are you giving Allah? How you can help and give and do something for Allah, for Him? Because if you are saying that, you are saying that Allah is weak. He's very weak and He needs help. Because those who need slaves are those who cannot do the job by themselves. They are not doing it because they like slaves. They are doing it because they cannot work in their farms and they need somebody to work for them. Why? Because they are very weak. But in our case, you can say, well, we are the slave of Allah because He owns us, He created us. So this 50%, yes, but we don't give Him nothing. He is giving us. So we are the slaves that are taken from the master, but the master is not taken from us. So in this case, it's an honor to be slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an honor. But Allah didn't tell us, you should be that because you are that. It's not what He wants from you, because you are that. You have no choice. If you have choice, He would tell you, okay, be my... But that's why you don't say to your son, be my son, because he doesn't have choice in that. Nor your son will tell you, be my father, because you don't have choice in that. You are that. We don't think even doesn't come to your mind because you don't think about it. So I don't know why the translator, they are thinking that we are slave of Allah and the mother that like slavery, what human and stuff, because this type of slavery, you have just 50% of it, which is He owns you, He controlled you, He created you, you belong to Him, but you don't give Him nothing. He is the one who is giving you. It's an honor for you. Your master is working for you. So, and this is not what He wants from you anyway, because you are that. Nor you cannot say also we are His servant, because what are you giving Him? What are you doing for Him? We are serving each other. That's the truth. I need you, you need me, you need the other one, he is doctor, he is medical doctor, this one is mechanic, this one is information technology technician, this, and so on, architects, constructor, and so on. We need each other, so we are serving each other. We don't serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the only real interpretation is worship, worshippers. We are worshippers. If you are following the commands of Allah, you can be proud and say, I am worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But don't say, I am slave of Allah. Because if you are, it's not your choice. It's not an option for you. You are that, you are godless, you like it, you don't like it. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought this matter, He brought it 5 times in the Quran. 5 verses in the Quran in five surahs, different surahs. All of them, they are talking about very similar things. وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ وَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ That's the only case He brought in. All verses, they are saying the same thing. And your Rabb, He is not offender, but He said in the what we call the Sifat Mubalagha, ظَلَّام وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ He is not offending Abid. Here Abid, slaves. Slaves that He created, all of them, He created them. They are His Abid. And He said He is not offending any one of them. So when He is bringing this, it means that all creatures, and especially all mankind, regardless if they believe it or not believe it, doesn't matter. But when He will specify the worship about His worshippers, He will say Ibad. وعباد الرحمن, and He will bring this beautiful sifat, these beautiful attributes of Ibad al-Rahman. Okay? Not the plural Abid. When Allah says, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Subhanahu alladhi asra bi'abdihi, Laylan min al-Masjid al-Haram, min al-Masjid al-Aqsa. You cannot translate it as Subhanallah, Allah who took during night time His servant or His slave. You cannot translate it like that. Because by telling us that His servant or slave, you are lowering Him. You are lowering Him by saying He is a regular one like everybody. But Abd there is worshipper. Because He deserved that miracle of taking Him for a journey night time from Mecca to Quds, and from Quds, the ascension to above the heavens. It's a huge miracle. Why He deserved that? Why did He deserve that? Because Allah said He is my Abd. If He was just a regular one like Abd that has plural of Abid, He doesn't deserve that. He is like anybody. But the Abd there has plural Ibad. And because He reached the highest level of worship, He deserved to be named Abd. من العابد plural عباد. You understand what I'm saying? Do you understand this room? Inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. So when you are saying it, this is the only weapon that you have to make shaitan away from you. And shaitan again is a title, it's not name. Shaitan is title. Like you say doctor, you say teacher, title. Shatana, ba'uda. Going away from what? From the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the case we are talking about. Shaitan is someone who is disobeying Allah. Can be among mankind, can be among jinn. The father of shaitans is Iblis. So Iblis is the name. But shaitan is title. Anyone who is disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shaitan. Among mankind, among jinn. So, when you say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, he cannot stay. He just cannot stay. He will run away. And that's why the Prophet always is commanding us to have wudu, to stay of wudu all the time. لا يحافظ على وضوء إلا مؤمن. This is a sign of believers. And it doesn't take that much time. I don't know what too many people are lazy about that. You just go to the bathroom, don't get out unless you do your wudu. It takes 2 minutes or 1 minute. And you are, mashallah, in the state of worship. State of worship. By having wudu, it's very hard for anyone to hurt you or jinn. Okay, or jinn. The shaitan of mankind, even if you have a million type of wudu, that will not stop mankind. But jinn, you are making shirk or veil or partition between you and the jinn, the bad one, not the Muslim one. And again, the social life of jinn, they are exactly like mankind. As some Muslims, they are not praying and will tell you they are Muslim. They are a copy of mankind, same thing. And sometimes they are worse. There are some of them, they are born Muslim and they will tell you Muslim and they are very bad. Very bad and they can hurt. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Iblis disobeyed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he told them prostrate, he said no. He said no. Someone can say, well, Adam also, Allah told him not to approach the tree with his wife, and he approached the tree, and not just he approached the tree, he ate from it. Both of them, they ate from the tree. So this is a sin, and this is a sin. And Allah forgive Adam, and they didn't forgive Iblis. Someone can ask why. And they are both of them, they are sinning. The answer is very simple. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was commanding Iblis to prostrate, Iblis rejected the command from the beginning. We don't say to Allah, no. We don't say to Allah, no. When Allah commanded Adam alayhi salam and his wife Hawa by telling them, do not approach this tree, they said, yes, we will not approach it. They didn't say, no, we can approach it. They said, yes. Meaning the command is accepted. Command is accepted. I don't know how much time it took to shaitan to mislead them from that. Allah knows best. It wasn't mentioned in the Quran how long. But for sure, it wasn't 1 day or 2 days, for sure. And especially when he was sworn by Allah. وَقَاسَمَهُمَا إِنِّي لَكُمَا مِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ قَاسَهُمَا, he was sworn by Allah that he is advising them. And Adam alayhi salam, he has no experience. Even he has knowledge, but he has no experience. What do I mean by that? He never thought that someone can swear by Allah and lie. He never thought that someone can swear by Allah and lie. So he thought that he was saying the truth. He wasn't listening to Allah. Allah said, إِنَّهُ لَكُمَا عَدُوهُمْ مُبِينٌ. Don't listen to him. He misled them. But they accepted the command. They didn't reject it. Then after that, they didn't fulfill that command. But Iblis from the beginning, he said, no. When you say to Allah, no, we are out of the mercy. When you say to Allah, no, we are out of mercy. And you can guess how many people they are saying to Allah, no. Pray, no. Fast, no. Believe, no. One no cursed Iblis. You can guess mankind how many no's they are saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah protect us and save us and guide us and guide everybody.
Amen.
Islam is so beautiful. Muslims are not selfish. Muslims, they like the good that they like for themselves, they like it for others. The good that they like for themselves, they like it for others. After that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commanded them to go from the place where they were. It was Jannah where they were. I call it school. School of test, of learning. Learning how to apply commands. And it was just one command. Because that Jannah is not the Jannah that is promised. That is promised, or it was promised to the believers. It's not that, for a couple of reasons. The first one, Allah said that Jannah, the promised one, if you enter to it, you will not get out from it. And this, Adam Aleyhisselam and his wife, they went out from the place where they were. So Allah will not lie. He said, you enter to it, you will not get out from it. The second reason that Allah said, when you go to that Jannah, the promised one, there is no taklif. No taklif, there is no restriction. No do, don't do. You are king in your place. In that place, well, there is a restriction by commanding them, don't approach that tree. So, it cannot be the Jannah, which is the promised one. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to create whatever He wants. It was Jannah as a school for them. Okay? I have heard just recently that some people, they start making others in doubt about who is first, Adam or Hawa. We come to this point now that start thinking about who is the first Adam or Hawa. And some they are saying, well, Hawa is first, but they have no evidence about it. I can tell them that, listen, Adam, as Allah said, He created Adam first, is Adam first. Not just that, scientifically He has the chromosome X and Y. Okay? The Hawa has just X, she doesn't have the Y. And you can take from X another X, but you cannot take from an X Y. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created her as the hadith said. It doesn't matter from where, which part He created her. Allah just likes to fulfill something. But she came from him anyway. He was first and she came from him. This will answer to another very important issue, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam from no father and no mother. Then He created Hawa, his wife, Eve. From him, he is the father. She doesn't have mother. She doesn't have mother. Then He created us from father and mother. If you believe that Allah is perfect, there is a gap that is missed that should be fulfilled during the history of human being. What do you think was missed? One gap, one case should happen. If it doesn't happen, Allah is not perfect. Astaghfirullah. So it should happen to say that Allah is perfect. So Allah can create from no father, no mother. That's the case of Adam alayhi salam. Allah can create from father without mother. That's the case of Eve, Hawa alayhi salam. Allah can create from father and mother. That's our example, all of us, mankind. What is missed? Can Allah create from mother without father? That's the only gap that is missed. There is no other case except that. There are four cases. If you are familiar with probability, the mathematical probability, the logic, the chapter logic, they are studying in probability and statistics. If you have two statements, you cannot have more than four cases in that statement. Two statements, you can take from that two statements four cases. Well, those who are studying logic, what they are saying is known by P and non-P, or P and Q and non-P and non-Q. Okay? So, if you take the statement of being born from or created from no father, no mother, is the case of Adam alayhi salam. Being created from father without mother is the case of Hawa alayhi salam. Being created from mother and father is the case of all mankind. One case is missed. It should happen. If it doesn't happen, Allah is not perfect. Astaghfirullah. And Allah wants it to happen in the case of Maryam alayhi salam and his son Isa alayhi salam. He created him from mother without father. And now you have all cases there. All cases there. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Let me go to Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Otherwise we will not finish today. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This verse started with B. B is letter. And by the way, the Arabic letters or Arabic alphabet or Arabic letters, we have two types of letters in Arabic. One type called Hurufu al-Mabani or Hurufu Mabna. The letters that we use to construct the world that belongs to the root of the world. The root of the world. That's called Huruf Mabna or Mabani. And the second type of letters are letters of Ma'na or Ma'ani. Are some type of letters that doesn't belong to the root. But you bring that letter to achieve a meaning. Allahu Akbar. The first example, the letters of Mabna, like if you take the any verb, any word, suppose to enter in Arabic. To enter in Arabic, dakhala. Dakhala is made with dal, kha, lam, three letters. If you take the dal out, it will not have the meaning of dakhala at all. It will be khalla. Khalla. Has nothing to do with the. To show to you that the letter belongs to the root of the word. That's harf mabna. If you take the kha from the middle, it will be dalla. Has nothing to do with dakhal. Just to give you an idea about the letters that belong to the root, we call them huruf mabna or huruf maban. Huruf ma'na or ma'ani are the letters that you bring by yourself to achieve a meaning, and B is one of them. B here is one of them. That's why in translating you say, you can see, translate B as with or by the name of Allah or with the name of Allah. You understand? So that has nothing to do with ism. It doesn't belong to the root of ism. Alright? Bismillah. So it, because it's letter of ma'na, it should have meaning. This letter should have meaning. And we say it means استعانة. حرف استعانة. حرف استعانة, it means that this verb will help you to achieve the meaning that you are asking help. It helps you to achieve the meaning of asking help. Because when we say Bismillah, Muslims, they used to it. Before eating, Bismillah, before doing anything, they will say Bismillah. Right? What do you mean by it? What do you mean by that when you are saying it? When you are saying it, if you say it with its real meaning, your iman is very strong. Because when you say, before you do something, you say Bismillah, you mean, Ya Allah, I know, I am very weak, I have no power. If you don't help me to do what I am going to do, I will never do it. That's what does Bismillah mean. Before you eat, before you do any action, this will always remind you in your mind and your heart that Allah is always there. So it will connect you to Allah all the time. But don't make it a habit. Don't make it a habit. Make it as a worship, not a habit. Because it's tradition. When it's tradition, you forget its meaning. You are saying just by tradition. And if this is your intention, you will not get the ajr of it. But if you are saying it and you mean it, by what? Because I'm going to drink. Bismillah. What I meant by that, Ya Allah, even if it's easy action, it's very hard for me. If you don't help me to do it, I will not do it. He may take your soul right away before you just come there, the soul goes. Left. You cannot do it anymore. Even you will fall. Your hand may be paralyzed. Your hand may be paralyzed. Water itself may be fall or something. Instead of touching it, you touch the table and the table and water will go. Will be pulled in the. So when you say Bismillah before you do something, you should mean it by saying in your mind, your intention, Ya Allah, I know myself. I am very weak. Without you, Ya Allah, I will not do nothing. So please help me with this. Bismillah. Ism has two origins. Sima, which is alama. Like ism is name. I'm going to give what its meaning in Arabic. Please stop me if I said something I didn't translate it. Sima, it means alama. Alama is sign, indication. Looks like the name of someone is an indication of his person. Or sumu, ism came from sumu. Sumu is ulu, high. Looks like when you call somebody, you will stand, will be higher than others. That name make him higher and different than others. Because you name him, it means you are addressing, you talk to him specifically, specially or specifically than others. Ism. Bismillah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the first verse of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he started by saying, Iqra bismi rabbik. A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Iqra bismi rabbik. When the Quran was revealed the first time, Allah said, Iqra bismi rabbik. Then, no, we are not reading that way. We are saying, Bismillah. So, why this happened and what is the difference between Rabb and between Allah, this beautiful name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Should we continue or we stop to pray? Let us talk to the doctor. We pray or we continue?
We can make at least the adhan, because the adhan time
will... What do you think, doctor?
Let's make adhan.
Let's make adhan, then we can
continue. Go ahead. So, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. The first time Quran was revealed by read by the name of your Rabb. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. خلق الإنسان من علق. اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم. علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Prophet when he was commanded to read, and when you are commanding someone to read, when you say to somebody, read or recite, it means that you know that he memorized something, that you know he memorized it and you want to hear it from him, or you are giving him a paper that he should read. Prophet has none of this. Jibreel alayhi salam was commanding him, read. Jibreel was bullshitting with himself too. And Prophet ﷺ is saying, ma ana biqari, I cannot read. Prophet was bullshitting with himself too. Someone is commanding to read, the other one is refusing. No, they refuse. Not, he's not refusing because he doesn't know nothing to read. So on. So each one is talking according to his ability. Prophet is answering according to his ability. Jibreel alayhi salam is commanding according to his ability. That's why he is telling, I am not telling you to read because you know something, or you memorize something, or I am giving you something. No, you read by the name of your Rabb. Because the Rabb who created you, he is able to make you read even if you didn't go to school. He will simplify the life for you. How long it takes you to have the knowledge you have? Too many years. And that's why he's telling, read by the name of your Rabb. And they know Rabb. Rabb, it can be Rabbul Usra, it can be a Rabb of, it means the owner of someone or the leader of something. And that's why Jibreel alayhi salam is saying, not the Rabb that you know among your family and your social life. I'm talking about the Rabb who created. Because there is no other Rabb pretend that he created something. So this will make difference. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. And he stopped there. Who created? He didn't say, what did he create? In the second verse, he will say, خلق الإنسان من علق. So the second one, he say, خلق الإنسان من علق. علق is the cloth that is suspended in the uterus. He is talking about the normal خلق coming from father and mother. But the first one, he didn't mention anything about it because it's the خلق of Adam عليه السلام. And that no one can bring it to the lab and do some experiment and try to create something from nothing, from dust and clay, from clay, you cannot do that. And Allah didn't emphasize in it because he knows you cannot discover that, you cannot make that, you cannot understand it, except you have to accept it. خلق اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. Then he will come and emphasize in something that you may discover. You may discover in the future. خلق الإنسان من علق. When this was revealed at the time of the Prophet, even after that, many centuries, the scientists at that time and doctors at that time, they thought, they used to think that mankind in the uterus of their mother are like they are, but they are miniaturized. They are just microscopic ones, small ones, but they are like they are, with their eyes and nose and everything, and they need just to grow. That's the concept that they have for many centuries after the Prophet, many centuries. They banned this one after the discovery of the microscope, and they start investigating the uterus and look and see what's going on. Then after they say, oh, that was a mistake. We were wrong. Mankind is not like that. He's going through too many steps to have the way how he will be rejected or born from the uterus as he is. A big process which is now we call the embryology. embryology is the science that is studying that the steps. And by the way, Professor Kate Moore, he's still alive. He's a Canadian professor of embryology. I have a video of him here saying that he believed that what the Quran, what Messenger of Allah is saying is from the Quran, and the Quran is from Allah, because there is no way that the Prophet can know these precise steps that he described in the Quran, that Allah created us from nutfa, then after that from alaqa, then after that after mudgha, mukhallaqa, wa ghayr mukhallaqa, and after that they will say create aydam, then thumma kasawna al-aydam al-hima, thumma anshana khalqan akhar. Bones, then we put flesh, cover with flesh, muscles on the bones, then after that we created a new khalqan akhar, new creature, different than the one before. He's talking about the same thing in the uterus. Certain time, it will be another creature completely different from all the stages he passed before. That's the time when he will have the ruh in. When he will have a ruh, start moving, khalqan akha. He's not that one who doesn't move. You understand what I'm saying? اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم. الأكرم is one of the beautiful names of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. الكريم is also one of the beautiful names of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Allah is كريم on me and you, because we study through the process of learning, education. Prophet Allah didn't go through that. He started reading from the first time. We don't, that doesn't need to go to the any school. Allah is teaching him through Jibreel alayhi salam. And that's why he said, wa rabbuka al-akram. Akram is more than kareem, toward us. The impact of the beautiful attribute toward us, but not toward Allah. Allah, his attributes, all of the riches, they reach the highest level of what they are. With the rizq, rahmah, karam, all of them the same at the level of that. Beyond that, these attributes became name because of the beautiful name of Allah. You understand what I am saying? For Allah, al-Karim and al-Akram is the same. But for us it's different. Karim is not Akram. You understand what I'm saying? So Allah is Akram to the Prophet because he was taught we don't go to school. And he's Karim for us because we are going through the process of education. A long, long process. Why I'm saying this? Because I said the first time when Quran was revealed, it was revealed by the name of Rabb. And now Allah is telling you, say Bismillahir Rahman, not Bismillah Rabbi, Bismillahir Rahman. And why again? Because Rabb came from Tarbiyah, has to do with Rububiyah. And Tarbiyah, when you talk about Tarbiyah, how many time I still have? Because I don't want people to keep waiting.
A couple of minutes.
Jazakallah khair.
We can continue after.
Yeah. After the prayer? Yeah. Okay. Allah is introducing himself in the first time by Rabb, and Rabb is Tarbiyah, is said. Rububiyah, Tarbiyah. And just put it in your mind, Rububiyah or Tarbiyah. Tarbiyah will explain. Rububiyah, anything you are getting from Allah, that's the field of Rububiyah. Anything you are getting from Allah, that's Rububiyah. And tell me what you don't get. Tell me what you don't get. Everything you are getting from Allah, that's Tarbiyah. That's Rububiyah, I'm sorry. That's Rububiyah. You understand? Uluhiyah is different. Uluhiyah is different. Uluhiyah is what you are doing to please to Allah, that's Uluhiyah. Whatever you are doing to please to Allah, that's Uluhiyah. Uluhiyya comes from down up. Yeah, because it has to do with ibadah, worship. Worship. So the worship, it comes from the worshippers. So it's from down to up. But rububiyya comes from up, down. So what you are getting from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rabb, and you, originally it came from tarbiyya. And if you look at tarbiyya, the way how it is written in Arabic, you will see ra and ba there. In the middle of the word, tarbiyya, rabbi is there. Tarbiyya. Tarbiyya is when you, process of learning, when you teach someone gradually, gradually is very important, step by step until you make him reaching the goal you want him to do, for his goal, what you want him to do. And that's why you see, you know, someone likes to go doctor, he will go through the process that will lead him to be medical doctor. Someone likes to be architect, he will go through the process that can lead him. So he is taught gradually until he will reach the level or the goal that he wants to do. Okay? So that's tarbiyya. In our, the way how we mankind looking at tarbiyya, you have curriculum to teach, but you don't care about anything else. You don't care about this student, did he eat his breakfast or not? Did he sleep well yesterday? What his mind is? Is he really motivated for you or not? You don't care about that much. You have curriculum, he is there, he has to listen or to participate, whatever the way how you are doing your strategy, okay, and your lesson planning, and he has to comply with that. And that's it. Allah doesn't look at the education that way. Allah is looking at your education before you were born. First, He prepared the place for you, the place that is convenient for your education. Then after that, He started educating you since you were, if there is something less than neutron and protons and electrons, if you, there is something less than that, that education starts that time, from that. Before you were, since you were electron, proton, neutron, and now they are finding something more than that, they are going deeper than that, the education of Allah started there, that time, and before. And he's following your growth. Since you were that electron, put them in that atom, and how many atoms you have. The biologists, they are saying that we are what, billions of cells. And when you talk about billions of cells, okay, how many atoms in one cell? That's the education of Allah. All this process is education of Allah. And that's why he said, I am your Rabb. Before I give you knowledge, I will prepare you for